takes the power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger. The King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You lay down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Chaos back into order, who makes the orphan a son and daughter. The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You lay down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. Thank you. side. Forever lift him high, with all creation cry, God, we praise you. So pour out your spirit with love to renew you, oh God. When you come with our heads to the heavens alive in your presence, oh God. When you come, so pour out your spirit with love to renew you, oh God. When you come, come like a rushing wind, come like the fire again, come like a burning flame. Have your way, have your way. Oh. Come like a rushing wind, come like the fire again, oh. Come like a burning flame. Have your way, have your way. I won't forget the wonder of how you brought deliverance, that the exodus of my heart. As you found me, you freed me, held back the waters from my release. Oh, Adonai, you're the God who fights for me, Lord of every victory. Guiding light to my feet. You found me, you freed me, held back the waters from my release. Oh, Adonai, you're the God who fights for me, Lord of every victory. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You have torn you stepped into my Egypt. You took me by the hand. You marched me out in freedom into the promised land. Now I will not forget you. I'll sing of all you've done. Death is swallowed up forever by the fury of your love. You stepped into my Egypt. You took me by the hand. You marched me out of freedom into the promised land. Now I'll not forget you. I'll sing of all you've done. Death is swallowed up forever by the fury of your love. You're the God who fights for me, Lord of Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the Dear Jesus, we thank you that we can rest, that you will never change, that you are truly our hope, that you make a way when there is no way. Lord, you're really all that we need, and that will never change. And I thank you that we can hold on to you, that you are steadfast, that you are faithful. Even when we are faithless, you remain faithful. Thank you for that, Lord. Thank you that we can stand on your firm foundation. Help us to do that. Help our hearts to cling to you today. Have your way in this service and in our hearts, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. And welcome to Grace at Home. Before we get into our teaching on Luke chapter 2, let's pray for our friends that don't know Jesus yet. And let's pray for ourselves as we open up God's Word today. Let's pray. Lord, we do thank you for our friends that haven't yet come to know you. We thank you that it's not your will that any should perish. And so we pray for our friends that you would do whatever it takes to bring our friends to a place where they would search for you and find you. If you'd like to use us in the process, we are available. Lord, we thank you for your word. We ask that as we open it up this morning, that it would be a lamp to our feet and a light to our path, that you would speak to our hearts, and that you would make a difference in our lives. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Amen. We'll open up your Bibles to Luke chapter 2. I'm going to read the first 20 verses. After I get a drink. Luke 2, starting with the first verse. At that time, the Roman Emperor Augustus decreed that a census should be taken throughout the Roman Empire. This was the first census taken when Quirinius was governor of Syria. All returned to their own ancestral towns to register for this census. And because Joseph was a descendant of King David, he had to go to Bethlehem in Judea, David's ancient home. He traveled there from the village of Nazareth in Galilee. He took with him Mary, to whom he was, He took with him Mary, to whom he was engaged, who was now expecting a child. And while they were there, the time came for her baby to be born. She gave birth to her firstborn son. She wrapped him snugly in strips of cloth and laid him in a manger, because there was no lodging available for them. That night there were shepherds staying in the field nearby, guarding their flocks of sheep. Suddenly an angel of the Lord appeared among them, and the radiance of the Lord's glory surrounded them. They were terrified. But the angel reassured them. "Don't be afraid," he said. "I bring you good news that will bring great joy to all people. The Savior, yes, the Messiah, the Lord, has been born today in Bethlehem, the city of David. And you will recognize him by this sign. You will find a baby wrapped snugly in strips of cloth lying in a manger." Suddenly, the angel was joined by a vast host of others, the armies of heaven, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and peace on earth to those with whom God is pleased." When the angels had returned to heaven, the shepherds said to each other, "Let's go to Bethlehem. Let's see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." They hurried to the village and found Mary and Joseph, and there was the baby lying in the manger. After seeing him, the shepherds told everyone what had happened and what the angel had said to them about this child. All who heard the shepherd's story were astonished. But Mary kept these things in her heart and thought about them often. The shepherds went back to their flocks, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen. It was just as the angel had told them. So, after God tells the parties that are involved about Jesus' birth, you know, Mary and Joseph, the first people he revealed all this to were shepherds. You might think, well, so? We know, we've seen all these plays and stuff at Christmas time. See, the significance of that is that shepherds were some of the most insignificant people in society at that time. And God came to shepherds. He didn't come to kings. He didn't come to the aristocracy. The first people he went to were insignificant shepherds. Most of the time we think, God doesn't care about me, I'm insignificant, and God wouldn't want to speak to me, God wouldn't want to show me his will for my life because I'm just an insignificant nobody. Well, that's what these shepherds were. They were insignificant nobodies. Their claim to fame was watching dirty, smelly sheep. And I think it's significant in our lives to understand that God doesn't think of one person, oh, he's a rich guy, we're going to treat him this way. Oh, he's a stinky poor guy, we're not going to speak to him at all. You know, God doesn't think that way. God loves you, no matter what station in life you happen to hold today. God loves you. He always has. He always will. Now, let's see what happens to the shepherds. First thing that happens to the shepherds, after they wet their pants and go change clothes, is that God speaks something to them. The angels come and announce to these shepherds, and they say, a Savior has been born to you. In other words, this is your Savior. So what were these shepherds doing? They were simply living out their lives tending sheep. This word changed their lives. And you might ask, well, why did it change their life? Well, because the first thing they did was to think about what the angel said. Now, how many times have you heard a good message in church or on the radio or on TV or on your computer, and the most you did with it was go tell somebody that was good. But you didn't really think about it much after it was over. You just knew it was good, had a couple of good jokes. These shepherds thought about what the angel said. They talked about it and they owned it. God brought us a Savior. Let's go find our Savior, right? He made a big deal about it, so let's go do something about what this guy said. Mark 4:24 is an important verse for Christians. Jesus says, consider carefully what you hear. He continued, with the measure you use, it will be measured to you and even more. Consider carefully what you hear. When we hear from God, we need to consider carefully what we hear. The shepherds did that. They thought about it. They meditated on it. They let it become part of who they were. We need to make it become a part of who we are. The shepherds considered what they heard, and it changed their lives. Psalms 1, verses 1 through 3, says, oh, the joy of those who do not follow the advice of the wicked, or stand around with sinners, or join in with mockers, but they delight in the law of the Lord, meditating on it day and night. Meditating, thinking about it, letting it become part of who you are, considering it. They are like trees planted along riverbank, bearing fruit each season. Their leaves never wither, and they prosper in all they do. Oh, good! I get to prosper! No, that's not talking about getting rich. See, Americans, when they hear prosper, that's all they think about. It's basically they're going to be successful in everything they do. Getting rich doesn't necessarily equate with being successful. Some rich people are not successful because they didn't do what God called them to do. You can have all the money in the world, but if you're not following Jesus, what good does it do you? A man can gain the whole world and yet lose his soul. That's what Jesus said. Another verse says, I have hidden your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. So what's this? What's the big deal about considering his word, thinking about it, meditating on it? What's the big deal about that? Hiding his word in my heart. What's the big deal? Excuse me. About that. We, as people, will do, eventually, what we're thinking about. So I've said this before to you, it's not thinking about not doing something that's going to get you to change your life. Because if I'm thinking, oh, I'm not going to eat that cookie. I'm not going to eat that cookie. I'm not going to eat that cookie. It's all about that cookie. What am I thinking about? Cookie. I'm thinking about eating the cookie. And what am I likely to do? Eat the cookie. That's right. That's a small example, but you know, when you're constantly thinking about things in this life, you're going to eventually do these things in this life. If you're thinking about things of God, think about godly things. Thinking about the Word of God all day long, day and night. You're likely to start doing the Word of God. Does that make sense to you? These shepherds thought about it, and they did what the angel told them to do. Joshua 1:8 says this, study this book of instruction continually, meditate on it day and night, so you will be sure to obey everything written in it. Only then will you prosper and succeed in all you do. See, just like Psalms 1, meditate on it day and night. When I study the Bible, what I want to come up with when I have my quiet time, I'm going to read as far as I need to find something that the Holy Spirit is pointing out that I can think about all day long. Because then I will start practicing what the Holy Spirit is obviously pointing out to me in that particular reading. Psalms 119, verses 97 through 100 says, oh, how I love your instructions. I think about them all day long. Your commands make me wiser than my enemies, for they are my constant guide. Yes, I have more insight than my teachers, for I am always thinking of your laws. I'm even wiser than my elders, for I have kept your commandments. Now, how did he end up keeping the commandments? How did he end up keeping the things and being wiser than all these people? Because he thinks about God's instructions all day long. He thinks about them all day long. Are you thinking about God's word and God's instruction all day long? And this brings us to the next point. I have kept your commands. The second thing they did was acted upon what they heard. They did something. You know, it's really nice to hear something and to believe something. But they did more than that. They did something. They went to find the baby, their savior. Who's watching the sheep when they did that? I don't know. Maybe one of them didn't want to go. But Mark 4:24, which we already read, consider carefully what you hear. He continued, for with the measure you use, it will be measured to you. And even more, with the measure you use. What does that mean? Well, I think about what I heard, and then with the amount that I put it into practice, it will be measured to me. In other words, whatever I sow, I will reap. If I'm sowing to the Spirit, I will reap eternal life. Sowing and reaping, it's a principle in the Bible. It's not about earning or getting money. It's about growing spiritual fruit in our lives. See, we're not going to harvest anything if we never sow seed. In other words, if I'm just sitting around saying, that was good. You should have heard that this morning. That was good. See, the shepherds, we're not going to accomplish anything if they didn't use what God said to them. And so they went into Bethlehem, they saw the baby, and then they were able to evangelize. We'll talk about that in a minute. Galatians 6, 7 and 8 says, do not be misled. You cannot mock the justice of God. You will always harvest what you plant. Those who live only to satisfy their own sinful desires, their own sinful nature, will harvest decay and death from that sinful nature. But those who live to please the Spirit will harvest everlasting life. Everlasting life from the Spirit. So how do I sow to please the Spirit? I'm glad you asked that. I put into practice what I hear. I own it, and then I act upon it. That word was for me, the shepherd said. That was for me. I'm going to go do something about what I heard. Matthew 7, verses 24 through 27. Says, anyone who listens to my teaching and follows it is wise. Anyone who listens to my teaching and follows it is wise. Like a person who builds his house on a rock. Builds his house on solid rock. Though the rain comes in torrents and the floodwaters rise and the winds beat against that house, it won't collapse, because it is built on bedrock. But anyone who hears my teaching and doesn't obey it is foolish. Anyone who hears my teaching and doesn't obey it is foolish, like a person who builds a house on sand. When the rains and floods come and the winds beat against that house, it will collapse with a mighty crash. See, these two guys, they both listen to his teaching. One of them follows it. The other one doesn't. The one who follows it has a storm come in his life. And the rains come, the winds beat against the house. But it doesn't crash. It doesn't collapse. Why? Because he has his foundation on the rock. What is the rock? Well, listening to Jesus' words and acting upon them. The one who hears the teaching, notice they both heard the teaching. But the one who hears the teaching and doesn't obey it, well, he has a storm coming in his life too. Sounds like the same storm. And yet his house collapses. Why? Well, he didn't have his foundation on the rock. He heard the word, but he wasn't putting it into practice. See, that's the key to having your house built on the rock, is that you're putting Jesus' words into practice. Now, a lot of times people want to say, well, the difference between the two guys is one listens to his word and the other one doesn't. No, they both listened to his word. See, the thing about this particular parable, it tells us in everybody's life, storms are going to come. The rain's going to come. The wind's going to beat against your house. Floodwaters are going to rise. How are you going to fare when the storm comes in your life? That's the question that we have to ask. It's only going to fare well if we're putting God's word into practice. I mean, you could say, that was a great message, Pastor, all you want to. It's not going to matter. What are you doing with that great message? Most of the time, you think a message is great. Not because the pastor is so great, but because the Holy Spirit spoke to your heart while the pastor was speaking. It wasn't the pastor who spoke to your heart. It was the Holy Spirit. And so you could say, well, it was a great message, Pastor. What are you going to do with that great message? Are you going to do something about it in your life? James 1:25, but if you look carefully into the perfect law that sets you free, and if you do what it says and don't forget what you heard, then God will bless you for doing it. If you do what it says and don't forget what you heard. It's both. You have to have heard it, thought about it, owned it, made it your own, and you needed to act upon it. See, God's promises are going to come true in our lives when we live out His word, when we trust Him. So we do what He commands. We trust Him, so we do what He commands. I'm sorry. People say, I don't ever see God doing anything. Well, get out of the boat. Well, Don, what do you mean by getting out of the boat? Well, I'm glad you asked that. You're asking good questions today. Look over Matthew chapter 14, starting with the 25th verse. It says, about 3 o'clock in the morning, Jesus came toward them walking on water. When the disciples saw him walking on the water, they were terrified. In their fear, they cried out, "It's a ghost!" But Jesus spoke to them at once. "Don't be afraid," he said. "Take courage. I am here." Then Peter called out to him, "Lord, if it's really you, tell me to come to you walking on the water." That's kind of a dumb thing. If it was a demon and the demon wanted to kill Peter, you know, okay, come on, you know. Jesus said, "Yes, come." So Peter went over the side of the boat and walked on the water toward Jesus. But when he saw the strong wind and waves, he was terrified and began to sink. "Save me, Lord," he shouted. Jesus immediately reached out and grabbed him. "You have so little faith," Jesus said. "Why did you doubt me?" Okay, the sinking after he walked on water is for another teaching at another time. But the bottom line is, Peter heard Jesus say, "Yes, come," and he jumped out of the boat and he walked on water. People don't walk on water. I know some people think they do, but people don't walk on water. That's what we call a miracle. And the only reason that Peter walked on water was because he heard Jesus say, "Yes, come," And he believed him. He believed that Jesus was calling him and that he could walk on water. It was when he started looking at the circumstances around him that he lost that faith and sunk. So as we consider his word and then put it into practice, own it and act upon it, the benefits that we reap will become a great harvest in our lives. We will see God do all sorts of tremendous things. And these shepherds owned what God said, they acted upon what they heard, and they spread the word. Shepherds, not theologians, not influential people, shepherds spread the word. If you think you're too insignificant to do God's work, shepherds weren't too insignificant. And they're at the bottom of the human food chain, so to speak. Look at Mark 4, 26 through 34. Jesus also said, the kingdom of God is like a farmer who scatters seed on the ground. Night and day while he's asleep or awake, the seed sprouts and grows, but he does not understand how it happens. The earth produces the crops on its own. First, a leaf blade pushes through, then the heads of wheat are formed, and finally the grain ripens. And as soon as the grain is ready, the farmer comes and harvests it with a sickle, for the harvest time has come. Jesus said, "How can I describe the kingdom of God? What story should I use to illustrate it? It's like a mustard seed plant in the ground. It's the smallest of all seeds, but it becomes the largest of all garden plants. It grows long branches, and birds can make nests in its shade." Jesus used many similar stories and illustrations to teach the people as much as they could understand. In fact, his public ministry never taught without using parables. But afterward, he was alone with his disciples. He explained everything to them. So, this guy goes out and he sows seed, just like the shepherds. They went out and told everybody about the baby that they had found and what the angels had said to them. It's like you and me. We just simply go tell people what Jesus has done for them, and then we just wait for God to produce a harvest in their life. Most people are not going to necessarily pastor somebody. You could disciple somebody, but Jesus is talking about, they go and they scatter seed all over the place. That's what you and I do. When your seed's scattering, you're not necessarily going to do anything else but just wait for it to grow. The Bible says God's word does not return void, but it accomplishes that to do. See, it's not your responsibility what happens to the seed after you've sown it. Am I making sense? That's God's thing. Now, God might call you, like I said, to disciple a person that you shared your testimony with. You know, he might bring somebody else into their life. But this parable says, you know, the wheat just grows, and as soon as the grain is ready, the farmer comes and harvests it with a sickle. And then he talks about the mustard seed. That the mustard seed is the smallest seed at that time known to man. And then it grows up to be a big plant. And we can have mustard. He's trying to let us know you don't have to have a lot of faith. I don't know how much faith the shepherds had. He's saying you just need as much faith as a mustard seed. And those shepherds went around spreading that mustard seed faith to all the people that would listen. And I bet something happened in a good number of their lives. Galatians 6:9. So let's not get tired of doing what is good. At just the right time, we will reap a harvest of blessing if we don't give up. See, sometimes people who are following Jesus get a little bit tired. Maybe they're not seeing the results in people's lives. Maybe they're not seeing the results in their life that they'd like to see. There have been times that I've wanted to quit doing something that God was telling me to do because I wasn't seeing it, you know, do its work. And the Lord told me, you know, what are you going to do when you get to heaven and somebody shows you that if you just waited just a little bit longer, all that you were hoping for would come true. But you quit. And it didn't come true. See, I don't want to get to heaven and see that. I don't want to get to heaven and find out, you know, if you had just gone on a little bit longer, everything you'd been praying for would come true. Don't give up. You will reap a harvest if you don't give up. That tells me I'm the only person who can stop me from reaping a harvest. You're the only person who can stop you from reaping a harvest. Am I making sense? Ephesians 3:20 says, now all glory to God, who is able, through his mighty power at work within us, to accomplish infinitely more than we might ask or think. I don't know, excuse me, I don't know about you, but I can think up a lot of things that I might want God to do for me. Can't you? Mm-hmm. And this says that he's able to accomplish infinitely more than we might ask or think. I mean, I think when we get to heaven, we're going to be blown away by what's there. That's going to be infinitely more than we can ask or think. Because we can only ask or think on this plane, this human plane, this mortal plane. God lives in eternity. Excuse me. And he can do much more than we can think on this human plane. Jeremiah 29:11 says, for I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord. They are plans for good and not disaster, to give you a future and a hope. I don't know why people think God's just out to get them. If God was just out to get you, he would have done nothing. He would have not sent Jesus. He would not have offered us salvation because of the blood of Jesus. He would have just let you go on, separated from him, and go to hell. That's all God had to do. But he had a plan that was good. It wasn't a plan for your disaster. It wasn't a plan for you to end up in hell. It was to give you a future. It was to give you a hope. That's the God that we serve. And so when he speaks to us, Let's consider carefully the word that he speaks and let's own it. Let's act on it. Let's put it into practice and see God's hand at work. Let's reap a harvest in our lives because we have owned his word and acted upon it. Does that make sense? Let's pray. Lord, I thank you that you spoke to shepherds, insignificant people as far as the world was concerned, but they were significant to you. And Lord, no matter how insignificant we might feel, we're significant to you. I pray that we never take for granted when you speak to our hearts. We never take for granted when we read your word and one of those verses jumps off the page at us. I pray that we would consider it carefully, that we would own it, and that we would act upon it so that we would become what your word says to us in our lives. I thank you that that's possible, but it's not possible unless we hear your word, we consider it carefully, and we own it and act upon it so that we can reap a harvest if we don't give up. Thank you for all of this, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, God bless you. I will see you next time.